Hello, everyone, and welcome to the show. Today we're going to be taking a look at Shovel Knight, the 2014 release from Yacht Club Games, due to a Kickstarter campaign. It's interesting how many good games start from there. Probably most notably the sequel to Divinity Original Sin and the Shadowrun games. Yacht Club, founded in 2011 by former Way Forward Technologies director Sean Velasco, leaped into popularity after its initial release, and with the release of the free DLC Plague of Shadows, we will no doubt see a lot more content from the expanding franchise. The 8-bit platform side-scroller generation was not so much about story, but rather the gameplay, until you had games like Ninja Gaiden come along. Even so, Shovel Knight's story is deliciously retro, dealing with magic going haywire and big baddies coming in to screw everything up. This would be a woman referred to only as the Enchantress, in command of her knights, the Order of No Quarter. With his beloved Shield Knight gone, our hero digs the graves, pun intended, of these other knights in order to reach the Tower of Fate and confront the Enchantress. Ever played DuckTales? Shovel Knight is similar in that way, where one of the most common ways to get past obstacles is to pogo jump. You can bounce off enemies to get better height, bounce on blocks to get treasure, or bounce on objects to activate other objects that open the way forward. The game offers interesting challenges, sometimes requiring you to navigate deadly traps in unique ways, and the mini-bosses present in each level add to the gauntlet without resembling a sort of checkpoint to break it up. While you have a life meter and a magic meter, you have no extra life counter. So when you die in a stage, usually by falling in a pit, some of your treasure stays behind in the spot where you died. There are many checkpoints in each stage, so dying doesn't punish you unfairly. And as for the health meter, you find meal tickets, or purchase them from the goatician in town, to add a point to your health. The prices increase exponentially each time you buy one, so it's worth collecting all the treasure you can find. Your magic meter can be increased by talking to the alchemist on the adjacent platform. Occasionally, you'll run into a squirrely man called Chester, who sells magic relics. The Fire Wand, the Phase Amulet, and others. You can also find him in town in the Underground Tavern with some other characters. On the surface, besides the other townsfolk, there's a bard who will pay you 500 gold for each music sheet you find, and that can really line your pockets if you put in the effort to find as many as you can. Further along, there is a second village that allows for weapon and armor upgrades. Upgrading your shovel will unlock abilities like a charge swing and a shock that travels along the ground when you have full health. The overworld map is reminiscent of Super Mario 3, with a grid that expands the further you get. It has curious areas along with each stage, like the pond where a fisherman gripes unless you buy a chalice from a vendor in the Underground Tavern. There are treasure stages that allow you to earn money, and unique areas that unlock relics. Along with those, there are wandering encounters with bosses called Baz and Rise and some others that are pretty difficult. But the boss fights are some of the most interesting ones ever witnessed by man. Reminiscent of Mega Man, each boss has a set list of moves. The patterns are pretty complex to say the least. Mole Knight, for instance, is surprisingly fast for a mole, spouting lava and launching walls of stone at you. The earlier tiers of enemies telegraph their moves longer, but are still pretty deadly. And the later tiers, like Plague Knight and the Explodatorium, gotta love that name, and Tinker Knight's Clockwork Tower, have tough stages and enemies that will raise your blood pressure tremendously. Tight controls and weapons that function properly make this extremely enjoyable, because nothing crushes a player's soul as fast as broken game mechanics. But there's nothing of the sort here. I would almost say it's flawless. I would be remiss if I didn't say that the soundtrack is epic, so much so that it warranted its own DLC. It has that classic chip sound without punching a hole in your eardrums. background music often gets overlooked, especially in recent titles. The full collection boasts 48 tracks in all. And Jake Kaufman did an incredible job using hobbyist programs, supplemented by the talents of Manami Matsume, the composer of the original Mega Man game. This track list might actually convince me to dust off that Famitracker program. Even though the platformer heyday has come and gone long ago, it is re-emerging with a vengeance. If you go by consoles before PCs became a thing, each generation had their own genre to claim. Early NES had the platform Jumpman-style side-scrollers. Super Nintendo and Sega Genesis had the fighting games like Street Fighter and Mortal Kombat, and those staple RPGs like Phantasy Star and Chrono Trigger. And the list goes on. It's nice to see what fresh eyes and a clean slate can come up with. Platform jumpers of this kind are few and far between in an era of shooters and multiplayer games. It's kind of a lost art. But the success of the Kickstarter that let this game be made shows that the old styles don't necessarily belong in the past. Shovel Knight doesn't pretend to be something that it's not. It doesn't have any bells or whistles. There's nothing locked away requiring a DLC purchase. It's just good, clean fun. Yacht Club cared about this game, and it shows. So if you have a chance, get this game, especially if you love the genre. You won't regret it. So, with that said, my name is Stormwolf, and I will see you next time.